मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
यस
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
अनमोड़ी एनीवन फ्रॉम बीगर अनमोड़ी।
सॉरी सर।
इज एनीवन फ्रॉम बीगर।
बिहार।
यस
सर
आई
डोंट नो सर। आई एम नॉट अवेयर। सर डू यू हैव एनी आइडिया व्हेन वुड द एनसेम बी हेल्ड?
No, no, not yet. They didn't have any discussion over the exam. In the last week, they had the convocation. I think they are busy with the convocation. Once the convocation, recently it was over. And now they will have a discussion with the exam. I think. Sabarni, your team is ready?
Yes, sir. I'm just waiting for Varshita to join. So we'll start after that.
Okay, there are around 90 people joined. If your team is ready, then you can start your meeting.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Nirmal? Nirmal join? Nirmal, Nirmal, please unmute. Unmute your mic, Nirmal.
Yes, sir.
Nirmal, your team is ready.
Yes, sir. You are ready, sir.
Yes.
So today we must present, sir.
Once the Sabarini team is over, then you can start your presentation.
Yes, sir.
Dhavani, you can start your presentation, Dhavani. Ask your
Yes, sir. Wait, I'll start. Is my screen visible? Is the screen visible to everyone?
Yes.
Good morning, sir. This is Varshita.
Yes, Varshita. Go ahead.
Sir, sorry for late. Sir, due to some network issues, we couldn't join on time.
You are talking about whom?
Sir, about me. Due to some network connection, I couldn't join on time, sir.
No issues.
Varshita, you can start reading.
So, good morning to everyone. Yesterday, our friend Yashasvi told about condition numbers for nonlinear equations for a single variable. Now, we'll be seeing the same for several variables. So, condition numbers can be defined for any function f mapping its data from some domain to some codomain. So this condition numbers can express how sensitive the function is to small changes in its orbit. So as a friend Rahul said, these condition numbers tell us how the output changes when we change this input, even the change is very small. And also this is very crucial in assessing sensitivity and potential accuracy difficulties of numerical computation problems. And this plays a very crucial role when we are finding polynomial roots and also while computing eigenvalues. Shaboni, next slide, please. Next slide, Shaboni. Yeah. So in condition number, we have two types. And one is absolute condition number and the other is relative condition number. Coming to absolute condition number, absolute condition number of a problem or a function at F can be, if you represent that with k cap, and it is epsilon tends to zero, like supremum of norm delta x less than or equal to epsilon, norm delta f by norm delta x, like where delta x is the change in the function when x changes from x to delta x. So, yeah. And if f is a differentiable function, we can write this k cap as Jacobian of x. Now coming to relative condition number, relative condition number of function, we can write it as limit epsilon tends to zero, like supremum of delta x less than or equal to epsilon, like the change, the relative change in the function to the ratio of relative change in the function to the relative change in x. So the main difference between the relative and absolute is in absolute condition number, we take the ratio of changes, whereas in relative, we take the ratio of relative changes of x. And yeah, and if x is differentiable, then we can write k as Jacobian of x divided by Jacobian of x norm f of x by norm x. Next slide, Shabu. So yeah, now we saw both relative condition number in absolute condition number, but in numerical methods, we in general use relative condition number mostly. So now, the condition number of f at a point x, like especially we consider here relative condition number. When we are saying condition number, we mean relative condition number, is then defined to be the maximum ratio of fractional change in f of x to any fractional change in x in the limit where change delta x in x becomes infinitesimally small. And the expression for the same, we can see that in the next slide. Yeah, this is the expression for the same. And if x is differentiable, which is equivalent to norm of Jacobian of x by norm f of x divided by norm x, where J of x denotes the Jacobian matrix of partial derivatives of f at x. Next slide, Sharma. Next slide, please. Yeah, now we'll see the example for two variables. Like, let us consider a function f of x equals to x1 minus x2. And Jacobian of the same is like partial derivative of f of x with respect to x1 and with respect to x2, and which we get as 2. For convenience, we take here, we consider infinite norm here because it returns the maximum absolute value in the given vectors. And the condition turns out to be like k is equal equals to norm Jacobi of x divided by norm f. As we saw in the before slide, if you substitute the same in the formula, we get 2 by mod x1 minus x2 and the maximum of mod of x1 comma x2. And this quantity which is large if mod x1 minus x2 is approximately equal to 0. And as a friend Rahul said, if you have a high condition number, then we say that the function is ill-conditioned. So here this x1 minus x2 becomes, if that becomes zero, then the quantity, the condition number becomes, it increases. It might become infinite. So this is, we'll say this as ill-conditioned. And that's all for my presentation. And my friend Napsal will continue with the next.
Hello everyone, this is Afzal. So now I'm going to talk about matrix condition number. So multiplication of a vector x by matrix a result in a new vector ax that can have a very different norm from x. The range of possible changes can be expressed by two numbers. Maximum is equal to maximum norm of ax by norm of x equal to norm a. Minimum is equal to minimum norm of ax by norm of x. Here the maximum minimum are over all non-zero vectors x. Now the definition. The condition number of non-singular matrix A is given by k of equal to maximum by minimum. By convention, if A is singular, m is equal to 0, then k of A is equal to infinity. Next slide, please. Okay, let Ax is equal to y, maximum is equal to maximum, norm of Ax by norm of x, which measures how much the mapping included stretch vectors. It is sometimes also important to consider how much matrix can shrink vectors. Minimum is equal to minimum, norm of Ax by norm x. The reciprocal of the minimum stretching is the norm of the inverse, because minimum is equal to minimum, norm of Ax by norm of x equal to minimum by minimum norm of y by a inverse y equal to 1 by maximum norm of a inverse y by norm of y is equal to 1 by norm a inverse. The ratio of the maximum to minimum stretching is the condition number for inverse. K of A is equal to maximum by minimum, which is equivalent to K of A is equal to norm of A into norm of inverse. Srikanth will continue from here.
Hi friends, good morning to everyone. My name is Srikanth. I'm going to say about the relative change and how coordination number influences it. Okay, as we see on the screen, let us take an equation Ax equal to B. Let there be a small change in B and it is called delta B. As the first equation shows Ax equal to B and we are introducing some error in B, that is delta B. So there should be an error in X. Let it be delta X. So as we already know Ax equal to B, now A into delta X equal to delta B. Shaboni, can you go to the 28th slide? Yeah, here we see capital M equal to max of norm of Ax divided by norm of X. As we know,
but here we'll go into.
In the capital M equation, replace Ax by B. Then when we remove max, then the equation will be holding an inequality, which is capital M greater than or equal to norm of Ax divided by norm of X. And similarly, the small m equation, by removing minimum, there will be an inequality small m less than or equal to norm of Ax divided by norm of X. In inequalities, we have a condition that if A less than B and C less than D, we can multiply both the equations by keeping the inequalities on the same side. So by using that condition, can you go to the next slide? Yeah, next. Next slide. Yeah, here we can see the inequalities norm of B less than or equal to cap lem into norm of X. Before slide. Yeah. Here we can see the inequalities. Norm of B less than or equal to cap lem of norm of X, and norm of delta B greater than or equal to small m into norm of delta X. By keeping the inequalities of the same side and multiplying, we get a relate to change in the X is less than or equal to condition number into relate to change in B. Yeah, the last slide, next one. So if the relative change in delta B, let it be some t, then relative change in X will become condition number of times of p. That means here condition number is acting as a magnification factor the times of relative change in delta B. That's it. Yeah, this is the end of the condition number, sorry. Thank you all.
Hello, good morning, sir.
It's good,
Hi friends, today I'm going to speak about the ill condition, well-conditioned system of equation. Yesterday, as our friend Rahul said the definition of ill-conditioned, well-conditioned system, today we will go into some clear explanation to some examples. Okay, let us consider the system of equations Ax is equal to b, where A is the coefficient matrix and x is some solution vector and b is any other vector. Okay, if there is any small change in A or B gives rise to large change in solution vector, then we will say that system of equation is in ill-conditioned system. Or if any small change in elements A or B leads to small change in system of equation, then we will say that system of equation is said to be well-conditioned. Okay, I will explain here through an example. Let us consider system of equation x plus 2y is equal to 4 and 2x plus 3.999y is equal to 7.999. Okay, here Ax is equal to b. If we wrote like this, and if we solve the solution vector, we will get x and y values as 2 and 1. And for instance, let A change to 1.001, 2.001. 2.001, 3.998. Then the new system of equation is wrote like this. Shabarni, can you go to next slide? Okay. By solving equation 2, we get the x and y values as 2.994 and 0.001388. Where we can see the small change in A leads to large change in the values of X and Y. For some instant, if B is changed to 4.001 and 7.998, then we can see that the solutions of X and Y as 3.999 and 4.00, where we can observe that small changes in B leads to large change in X. So by the definition of ill-conditioned system, we can clearly get to know that the first system of equation is in ill-conditioned system of equations. Okay, let us go to one more example. Take another system of equations as x plus 2y is equal to 4 and 2x plus 3y is equal to 7. So by solving the opposite system of equation, we get the x and y values as 2 and 1. And for some instant, let us change A to 1.001, 2.001, 2.001, 3.001. Then after solve, then after changing a, after changing a, then the new system of equation is wrote like this. Then by solving above equation, we'll get the x and y values as 2.003 and 0.997. If we observe, these values are very close to the initial values. That is, the x dash values are very close to x values. So we will get that small changes in A leads to small change in X. And suppose if B is changed to 4.001, 7.001, then after solving that system of equation, we will get X dash as 1.999 and 1.001. It is also very close to the initial value system. So by this we will clearly get to know that the above system of equation is a well-conditioned system, because if you see, there is only very small change in solutions. So we will say that above system of equations are well-conditioned system. Okay. If you see that the above system of equations is a simple set of equation, that means only two equations are there. Suppose if you have more number of equations, then it is difficult to say whether the system of equations are ill-conditioned, well-conditioned system. So in that case, we will use another terminology called norm. It is simple. It is simply called norm matrix or infinity matrix, etc. Okay, if you see a use of norm or matrix norm to describe the condition of system of equation. Let us discuss about the norm first. What is norm? Norm is nothing but the maximum value for all values in a matrix. For example, if we take one row matrix, suppose for example some x is equal to 2 and 3, what is the norm of that matrix is absolutely 3, because by definition we will get that norm is nothing but the maximum value of all values in a matrix. Okay, let us see another example. In this example, we will solve the system of equation through matrix norms. Okay. Let us consider the AX is equal to B, 1, 2, 2, 3.999, XY, 4.4, 7.999. By solving one, we get the solution vector values as 2 and 1. So infinity norm of solution vector X is absolutely 2, because if we observe in X, we get the values 2 and 1. By the definition of norm, we will get to know that the infinity norm of above solution vector is 2, and infinity vector of B, that is.
Hello?
That is norm mode B is equal to 7.999. For some instant, let us change B to B dash as 4.001 and 7.998. So the new system of equations like this. So if we solve the equation 2, we get the solution vector values as -3.999 and 4.000. So now change in B, that is delta B, means B dash minus B. Final solution vector value minus initial vector values, B dash minus B, that is equal to 0.001 and minus 0.001. Same like that, the change in X, that is delta X, is equal to minus 5.9993. So if you take the matrix norm to delta B and delta X, we'll get 0.0, that is norm mode delta B suffix infinity is equal to 0.001, and norm mode delta X suffix infinity is equal to 5.999, like this. Shabani, can you move to next slide? Hello. Now if we see the relative change in norm of B, that is norm mode delta B by norm mode B, that is equal to 0.001 by 7.999, we'll get 0.001125. similarly the relative change in norm of x, that is norm mod delta x by norm mod x, that is equal to 2.995. now change in solution vector with respect to b will get as 23993. If we observe that values is very large, so we will consider the system of equation as ill condition system. Everyone, next slide. Hello. Okay.
Yes, just a minute.
By the above examples.
Just a minute. Just a minute. Now, Rukashik, go back. Go to the last slide.
Go to the last slide.
Savarni. One more. Give F5, control F5. Yes, this is what we want. 35. Give control F5, Sabarni. It is okay, and give control F5. Yes, current slide. Yes. Yes, I have now Kaushik. I have a doubt that we have 0.001 is okay, and how we got 1.999?
Where, sir? Point. No, sir.
Oh, that is.
I didn't get it. Delta B and B.
That too.
Yes,
that
sir.
Too.
Delta B and B.
8. Is it so? 1.998.
Go back. 8. Wait. Previous.
Yes. 0.001 for delta B. Now delta B.
Yes.
Is, 0.001 yes, is okay. And. Okay, norm B is 7.998. Is it right?
Yes. Norm B, no. Sir.
Right. You are yes. Right.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, delta sir.
Delta X.
Norm is nothing but the maximum value, sir. So if you see in B vector, we have 4 and 7.99, sir. The maximum value is 7.99 only, sir.
No issues with the flights. These are right.
Okay.
All the values are right. Okay. Go ahead.
Kavarni, next slide. Next slide. Okay. By the above examples, we'll recall Sevarni, previous slide, Sevarni. Hello. Yeah. By the above examples, we will again recall the definition of condition number. So because we will get some clear definition, we will get some clear intention. So what is condition number? It is a function which measures how much the output value changes for a small change in input value. That is the definition, as our friend already said before. Okay, by using the matrix norm, the definition of condition number, the definition of by using matrix norm, condition number of a matrix A is given by norm mod A into norm mod A inverse. Okay, we'll go to the example. Let us consider a system of equation AX is equal to B, 1.001 solution vector xy and another vector 2. If we solve the above equation, we'll get x and y values as 2 and 0. Okay, if b is changed to 2 and 2.001, then by solving the above equation, new equation, we'll get x and y values as 1 and 1, Varney, next slide. So if we observe x, if you observe the x and y values to the previous values, there is a lot of change, 2 to 1, and 2 to 1 and 1 to 1. So by this we will clearly know that the above system of equation is ill condition, and by using matrix norm or the condition number, the condition number, we will solve this. Let us take A is equal to the 1 and 1.001. For A, the norm mode A suffix infinity, that is equal to 2.001. How means, suppose the RAM or the row matrix 1 and 1, 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, and another row matrix 1 plus 1.001. If we see the biggest value, if we see, if we take the largest value, we'll get the norm mode A suffix infinity as 2.001. And for the above matrix, if we do the inverse and take the norm mode inverse suffix infinity, we'll get 2001. So by the formula of condition number, norm mode A suffix infinity and norm mode A inverse suffix infinity, that is equal to 2.001 multiplied with 2001, we will get 4004.001. The condition, if you observe, the condition number is very large, so the system of equation is ill condition. Abhan, the last slide. Now the last slide, we'll go with another example of well conditioned system. Okay, let us consider a system of equation like this, 1 2 2 3, so like this, and the if we take the norm mode A of suffix infinity, that is the maximum of first row, that is 1 plus 2, and second row 2 plus 3. 1 plus 2 is 3 and 2 plus 3 is 5, so the maximum value is absolutely 5. And let us do A inverse. We'll and after doing inverse, if we take the norm mode A inverse suffix infinity, that is maximum of first row, that is -3 plus 2, and second row 2 plus of -1. Here we have to take only magnitude, there is no need of sign. So because it norm is nothing but maximum value, and here we're taking modulus, so there is no need of sign. We will consider only the magnitude. So maximum value of 5, 3 is 5, and by formula, if we take the norm matrix norm of condition of A matrix, that is the condition number of A is equal to norm mode A suffix infinity into norm mode A inverse suffix infinity, that is 5 into 5, that is 25. Compared to the above value, it is very small. 25 is, the above value is 4004 something, and this value is 25, is very less. So we will by this we will clearly get to know that this system of equation is well conditioned. Okay, this is our presentation. Hope you all people understand our condition number concept. Thank you, sir.
Just a minute, Savarni, for last slide. Stay with the slides, Savarni. Go back. Yes, just a minute. Last slide, example 4.
Previous slide.
Have you verified the inverse matrix, Navrup Kaushik, for matrix
yes,
example
sir.
Number 4?
Yes, sir. Sabani, move to next slide. Hello, Shaban, you move to next slide. Sir, here, sir, A and A inverse. For mat, for which one, sir? For example, 4, sir.
But this is A inverse is too large. Is it right?
Oh, it's 1:01:00.
Please check with the data. We'll get based on my experience, we'll get 0.99.
Yes, sir.
And minus 0.999 and 1, you'll get 1001 is too large. So anyway, you please cross check if it is feasible in our MSQ. Okay. Solve this particular example. Okay. Upload with the different answers.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. I will check and I'll verify, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay. It is very nice presentation, Varshita, Mohd Afzal, Amala Srikant, and Nauro Kaushe. My opinion is you have given very larger content to Nauro Kaushe. It may be scattered to even Varshita, Afzal, Srikant. That is what the point which we can discuss. The rest are all good, fine. I think Nauro Kaushik interestedly taken the responsibility. I think so. Is it so, Nauro Kaushik?
Okay, sir. No, sir. That I will. Is there any problem, sir?
Okay. You are taken to too much content when compared to your friends. Okay, fine.
No problem, sir.
Oh, fine.
If there is any mistakes, I'm sorry for that.
No.
Very good. Okay. Nirmal. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Kalyan, you can
start. Prithvi, need to share the slides now. Yeah. So, hi everyone. Good morning. I'm Kalyan and I'm here to explain briefly about the theory of Taylor series. Next slide. Next slide, please.
Builder.
Next slide, please.
Yeah. One second. Is it visible now?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. So Taylor series are one of the most powerful tools that math has to offer for approximating functions. Yeah, it's about taking non-polynomial functions and finding polynomials that approximate them near some input. Yeah, next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah, why do we need Taylor series? So polynomials tend to be much easier to deal with than other functions. They are really easier to compute, easier to take derivatives, easier to integrate. They are really just friendly. Next slide. Yeah. Let's take, for example, a non-polynomial function like cos x. The reason we are taking cos x because we can see cos x in really many physics equations and math equations like potential energy equations, in simple harmonic motion equations, in pendulums. And when we compute the cos of small angles, it's very really difficult to compute those angles. So we will use Taylor series to help to compute the cos of small angles. So, yeah, next slide, please. Yeah, if we take cos x as 1 minus x squared by 2, and if we compare those two graphs and
near that point x is equal to 0, the graphs look really well similar. You can look. The graphs really resemble each other at x is equal to 0. So if we take 1 minus x square by 2 instead of cos x for small values of x, we can easily compute with this polynomial. So we need to understand how we can find these polynomials in this next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah, let's assume a normal polynomial like p of x as c naught plus c1x plus c2x squared. Yeah, the first thing we need to understand is at x is equal to 0, cos x is equal to 1. So let's just plug in x is equal to 0, then we can get c naught is equal to 1. Next slide, please. Yeah, next slide. Yeah, since we got c naught, now we can we need to find c1. Yeah, so we found the value at x is equal to 0 as 1, then we need to find that polynomial should have the same tangent as cos x at x is equal to 0, otherwise the graph would go way off very suddenly. So we can find the tangent of cos x by differentiating it. At sine, differentiating cos x, we get minus sin x, and at x is equal to 0, it will be 0. And we differentiate our polynomial, and at x is equal to 0, we get c1 equal to 0. So the coefficient of x is 0. Okay, the next slide, please. Yeah. After we found that tangent approximation, we can see the rate of change. Our polynomial, the polynomial we want to find, must decrease in the same rate as cos x from and that x is equal to 0. So we differentiate cos x twice, and we get at x is equal to 0 the value of minus 1. So we are differentiating p of x twice, and at x is equal to for the value of minus 1, our value of c2 must be minus 1 by 2. So we get our polynomial as 1 minus 1 by 2 x squared. Next slide, please. Yeah, we can see that approximation at cos 1 minus 1 by 2 of point 1. If we take the value of x as 0.1, that 1 minus 1 by 2 x squared value is 0.995. And cos of 0.1 is 0.9950042. It's really, really a good approximation. It's like it's differ by one millionth. So it's a really good approximation. Next slide, please. Okay, now it's very good. It's really good if we stop at x square. But what if we continue those terms? We can see the graph resembles. Our polynomial graph resembles more in cos x if we add 1 by 24 x power 4. If we really continue those terms, the graph will start to resemble more with cos x. Next slide, please. If we generalize these steps, our polynomial called as Taylor polynomial will look like this. P of x is equal to f of 0 plus differentiating at that point, that will be the coefficient of x. Yeah, we can see the factorials coming underneath in these terms, right? Because we are using that power rule in differentiation, so we need to divide by it too. So that's why we are getting these factorials. This is for point x is equal to 0. That's why we are differentiating that function at x is equal to 0. Okay, if you want for any point, any x point in x, we can see the function. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is the most generalized for polynomial look like in their fullest generality. You can see this Taylor series polynomial. Yeah, Taylor series Taylor polynomial equation. It's an infinite equation, and it's really good for approximating our non-polynomial functions. And yeah, if you want to have a, if you, we can't take cos of 0.1 compute without using calculator, but we can find cos of 0.1 by using 1 minus 1 by 2 x square like that. Yeah, it's really, really useful. That's it for my presentation, and my friend Arvind will continue with an approximating the Taylor, approximation using Taylor series. Thank you.
Thank you, Kalyan. I'm Arvind Joshin, and I'm here to apply the explanation of the Kalyan's concept by using an example. So here is a problem statement. So they have given a function f of x is equals to minus 0.1 x power 4 minus 0.15 x cube minus 0.5 x square minus 0.25 x plus 1.2. So here what they have given, from x of y is equal to 0 with h is equal to 1. So h is x of y plus 1 minus x of y. So here we have to predict the function's value of at x of y plus 1 is equal to 1. So this is a easy polynomial function. So Kalyan explained for cos x, but this is an easy polynomial function. So it is not that level difficult to understand here. So the results for function f is equal to 0 is f of 0 is 1.2, substituting here, and f of 1 is 0.2. So the true value that you are trying to predict is actually 0.2. Okay. So the Taylor series approximation with n is equal, n is the degree, nth degree. Like, so for n is equal to 0, by putting x is equal to 0, we'll directly get 1.2, f of x is equal to 1.2. Next slide, please. And here you can see how, I mean, the order takes us to the original value. So here, this is the first zero order, and first order, second order, and the true values, and the fourth order. Next slide, please. So yeah, so by using the zero order, since a zero order approximation is a concept, here we are using a new term called truncation error. So this error is when you approximate infinite sum things, we'll use this error here. So here it is a 0.2 minus 1.2, so it is minus 0.1. So same for at x is equal to 1, for n is equal to 1, the first derivative. So the function is the above mentioned. So the first derivative of the function is minus 0.4 x cube minus 0.45 x square minus x minus 2.5. So at x is equal to 0, we'll be getting f of x plus 1 is approximately equal to 1.2 minus 0.25 h. So h is xi minus x of y plus 1 minus xi, which is in the given question, it is h is equal to 1. So we can use this to compute f of 1 is equal to 0.95, and you can see the slope of the trajectory is going down. So since, I mean, from the last slide, you might have understood it. So again, applying truncation error here, so it is minus 0.2 minus 0.95, it's minus 0.75. So again, going for the second derivative, we get the polynomial function looks like minus 1.2 x square minus 0.9 x minus minus 0.1. So as substitute, I mean, finding at x is equal to 0, we get minus 0.1. So according to the total equation becomes f of x plus 1 is approximately equal to 1.2 minus 0.25 h minus 0.5 h square. So here substituting for h is equal to 1 and f of 1, so we get 0.45. Again, applying the truncation error here, minus 0.2 minus 0.45, we get minus 0.25. Next slide, please. Yeah, so I mean, even if you go for the third derivative looks like minus 0.45x minus 0.9, and the next derivative, fourth derivative, looks like minus 2.4. So you'll get the exactly same thing from where we started. Since it's a fourth order polynomial, fifth order doesn't make sense here, so it is anyway zero. So approximating all these things, at x of y plus 1 is equal to 1, we get f of 1 is equal to minus 0.2, which we are supposed to get. And this is the application of the Taylor series concept, and my friend Praveen will explain this with another example. Thank you.
Thank you, Arvind.
Good afternoon, guys. I'm Praveen Raj, and I'm here to explain the use of Taylor series expansion to approximate a function with infinite number of derivatives. So, as we know, the formula of Taylor series is f of b is equal to f of a plus f dash of a by 1 factorial into minus the b minus a and so on. Next slide, please. And this is the formula, guys. So we have chosen a problem involving cos x. So here we are going to find the value of function f of x at pi by 3 with the help of derivative at pi by 4, where the function f of x is accounted for cos x. So as per the formula, we take the approximation. So the zeroth order approximation goes like f of pi by 3 is equal to cos pi by 4, which is equal to 1 by root 2, and the value of it is 0.707. So we take a percent relative error of the difference, and we get around minus 41.4% error. So we go for first order approximation. So in the first order approximation, we add the first derivative term of f of x, which is minus sine x of which is the first derivative of cos x. So for this first order approximation, we get the term cos pi by 4 minus sine pi by 4, and we add the b minus a term, include the product of we multiply it with this first term. So we get like 0.521. So and here we get the error percentage around like minus 4.4, like 10 times the error percentage has been reduced in the first approximation itself. Next slide, please. So in the second order approximation, we go for the second order approximation. So cos pi by 4 minus sine pi by 4 into pi by 12 minus of further differentiation of minus sine of x. So we get like cos pi by 4. Then we need to add the two factor in the denominator. So we get 2 below down there. Then it goes for b minus a the whole square. So it accounts for pi by 12 the whole square. So when solving it, we get the value of 0.497. So here the relative percent error has further reduced 10 times, and it has come down to 0.449%. Thus, the inclusion of additional terms in furthermore approximation results in an improved estimate. So this they have said us to do like six order approximations, and the table below given below has error values given. So we can understand. Next slide, please. So these are the values for six order approximations. So we can see the relative error furthermore decreases so minutely that it comes like nearly to 99.9738% at the sixth order approximation. So we can again proves that the approximations are very useful in finding the series value of the function at a given particular value. Thank you. So now I give over the presentation to my next guy.
Okay, with Praveen Raj's presentation, I will wind up today's class. I request others to continue during 12:30 tomorrow. And my appreciation to Kalyan, Alain Roshan, and Praveen Raj. You did a nice presentation. Nirmal, around four people, yes, are there in your team.
Yes, sir.
Okay, tomorrow we'll meet. Thank you. Thank you.